Hello there. Welcome once again to another Sunday afternoon here in the UK. First of all, the clocks have gone forward by 1 hour, just in case you are wondering why I am here at a different time. I'm not. It is the same time, but now we are into British summertime. You can see that everything is looking very lovely. Nature has once more woken up. You can see behind me there is lots of blossom. Doesn't it look lovely? So lots of things coming your way today. We have many things to talk about, including Article 13. What is Article 13, I hear you ask? We will talk about that today. Also, maybe we will mention Brexit, because that is in the news at the moment. Also, Mr. Steve will be here talking about words, expressions, all sorts of idioms to do with time. And you are more than welcome to join in on the live chat as well. Also, we will be talking about going into hospital, words and phrases connected to going into hospital and hospitals in general. All that to come today. After all, it's a Sunday afternoon. It's just after 2 p.m. here in the UK, British summertime. And this is English in your ear live. Here we go again. I hope you are ready. Yes, it is Sunday once more, and here we go again. Hi everybody, how are you today? My name is Mr. Duncan. Are you happy? I hope so. Are you feeling great today? I really, really hope so. So here we are live once again. It's Sunday. It's a fun day. It's time to improve your English listening with English in your ear live. We are now talking live to each other. I am talking to you through my video camera, and you can talk to me through the live chat. The whole world is watching right now. First of all, the big question must be, did you get here at the right time? Now, it is coming up to 10 minutes past 2 o'clock on a Sunday afternoon. It is the final day of March. We are about to go into April, a new month, lots of new challenges facing the human race over the next 4 weeks. Some of those things I will talk about a little bit later on the live stream. Also, we have you, as I've mentioned already, and we'll be talking about some other things today, including something that I mentioned during the week on one of my special live streams in the garden. And that is Article 13. Now, this will affect many people who create or produce content that goes out over the internet. And it might, I'm not sure at the moment, but it might also affect me. So we will have to wait and see what happens. So I'm not sure. It might affect me. It might not. So at the moment, we are not certain. So it's Sunday and the clocks have gone forward by 1 hour. This is very important. I must mention this, and I probably will mention it a few times today. But the clocks have gone forward by 1 hour. So it is still 10 minutes past two here in the afternoon. But where you are, it might be a different time because we have changed our clocks. We have moved them forward by 1 hour. I do know that many people also around the world will change their clocks today. In fact, some have already done it, including the USA. So many people do this as summer arrives. So the clocks normally go back 1 hour before winter arrives, and the clocks go forward again just as summer arrives. So we call this particular period British summertime, and then later in the year we go back to GMT, which is Greenwich Mean Time. Have you ever been to Greenwich? There is the most amazing place in Greenwich, which is just outside London, and it's the Greenwich Observatory. And it's where the time zones change. So the meridian line that runs around the world, it separates the day from today to yesterday, from tomorrow to today. It actually is in London. The Greenwich Meridian Line, we call it. It isn't a real line. It is just imaginary. So that's why we say GMT. Greenwich Mean Time. But now we are into British summertime. Although today it doesn't feel like summer is here, to be honest. Let's have a look outside. So here we go, a live view. That is the view at the moment outside my studio window. Are you enjoying the view today? I was live during the week. I did a couple of live streams in the garden because we had such lovely weather this week. Just in case you missed them, my live streams are available to watch again on my YouTube channel. So there it is, the view out of the window right now. And you can see in the distance, you might be able to see some yellow in the distance. And that is this year's crop of rapeseed. So you can see in the distance already the rapeseed is starting to come into flower, and in a few weeks time many of the fields in the distance will all be covered in a beautiful yellow glow. So around this area many people do grow rapeseed. It is something that is done quite often. So I hope you enjoyed that view out of the window. A lot of people are very interested to see the area in which I live because it is in the countryside. There are some lovely views, lovely sounds. And can I say thank you very much for all of your lovely messages during the week saying how much you enjoyed not only seeing me, but also hearing the sounds of nature as well. I must admit, I do love it. I love nature. I love being in this part of the UK. There is something I've forgotten. I've forgotten to mention the live chat. So let's have a look, shall we? The live chat is now on. Can you see it on your screen? You should be able to see it. I wonder who was first on the live chat today. Let's have a look, shall we? Let's go back to the beginning of the live chat. I'm always very interested to see if there are any new people. So if it is your first time today, please let me know. Hello to Malinoa. Hello, Malinoa. I don't recognize your name. Is it your first time today? And congratulations for being first on the live chat as well. I suppose that deserves a round of applause. Well done. Well done. You are first on the live chat today. Congratulations to you. Who else is on? We have also Gosia. Hello, Gosia. Nice to see you here as well. Also Martha, Kaiba, Lilia. Hey, hello, Mr. Duncan, and hello, class. Also, Mr. Bruno is here. Hello together. Again, I'm happy to be here. Hello, Mr. Bruno. Belarusia is here. Oh, Belarusia, can I ask you a question? How was your party last week? You went to a party. I remember you telling me, was it a good party? Did you have a good time? I hope so. Hang is here. Julie, Kaiba is here. Tomek. Hello, Tomek. Also, Leila, Vitas, and Grace. Hello, Grace Chin, watching as well. So many people here today already. I am very pleased to see that you've managed not to get confused, because between you and me, every year when we have to change the clocks, so when we turn the clocks forwards or backwards, I always get very confused. I'm easily confused. You may have noticed. Louis is here. Also Lulu, Palmyra. Hello, everyone. Hello to Facebook friends as well. Yes, I do have a Facebook page. I do. Guadalupe, Mika. Hello to Mika. What a lovely day you have today. It isn't too bad. It's a little cold, very windy. So when I went out this morning to do some filming, it was really chilly. Not as warm as it was last week when I was in the garden, but it's still nice. There is still sunshine. Mirella is here. Also Connell. Hello, everyone, and hello to Mr. Duncan. Rosa says hello, Mr. Duncan. Also we have Jiang or Giang, Alamgir, Pedro. It is Sunday. It's a fun day. It's English in your ear. Mr. Duncan, the other day I was wrong. You were right. It was 1 hour forward, not backwards. Yes, we go forwards in late spring, early summer. And there's an easy way of remembering this, because we can say that you fall back in autumn and you fall forward in summer. So you go back 1 hour before winter arrives, and just before summer arrives, you go forward 1 hour. So there is an easy way of remembering that. Rosa says, hello, Alamgir, Mika, Belarusia, and Pedro. Thank you, Rosa. That's very kind of you. Saying hello to everyone. on the live chat. Seka, hello to everyone, and a big hello to everybody from Barcelona. Thank you very much. Wow, so many people are here. Lena is here as well. Also, we have Min watching in Vietnam. Can I say a big hello to everyone watching in Vietnam? Apparently, a lot of people are very excited about the flags. So at around about 3 o'clock, we always have a little break and we show the flags of the world. So a lot of people get very excited when I show the flags of the world, and we will be taking a break at 3 o'clock to take a look at those. Alamgir is here. Also, Goob Jogger. I've been teaching words related to going into hospital and questions that doctors might ask patients. For example, you might say, I've got blotches all over my skin. And the doctors say, let me see your tongue. This happens a lot when you go to the doctors. Quite often the doctor will take a look inside your mouth. And quite often he will say, open wide, open your mouth as wide as you can. And also they might say, can you please stick your tongue out? So you have to put your tongue out like that. And also they might get you to say ah, because they want to take a look in your throat. So yes, thank you very much, Goob Jogger, for that. Brilliant. And we are talking about hospital words today. We are going to do that later on. Dinar says, I live in Azerbaijan. Hello to you. Nice to see you here. Anto is here. Wow, so many people already joining me today. Thank you very much. We also have Martha in Poland and Fast Idiomas. Hello, Fast Idiomas. It's nice to see you here again. I know that you were here during the week when I was in the garden. And we might do that again next week. It just depends on what the weather is like. Where is Mr. Steve? He will be here later. Sophia is here as well. And we also have Jonathan. Jonathan Eduardo, hello to you. Where are you watching at the moment? If it is your first time here today, please let me know, because I'm always interested to find out. Mohammed Soliman says, hello, Mr. Duncan. Did you hear about Mohammed Salah, the Egyptian football player who plays in Liverpool? I have heard of him. I'm not a big fan of football. I don't follow football very much, to be honest. However, sometimes Mr. Steve and myself, we like to go out into the garden to have a little game of football. Okay, perhaps we are not as good at football as Mo Salah.
I think that is very safe to say. It's a Sunday. It's a fun day. It's time to improve your listening. I hope you are having a good day. It is the final day of March. March is going. Goodbye, March. Goodbye. A couple of days ago, something was supposed to happen. Do you know what it was? It was Brexit, but it didn't happen. And that's why I went into the garden on Friday to talk all about Brexit and the reason why we are not now having Brexit. It has been put on hold for a while. It might still happen next month, or it might happen in June, but at the moment, no one really knows. And another thing I want to tell you, Mr. Steve is off at the moment. He is taking a break from work. So we might do another special live stream in the garden. I'm not sure at the moment. We might do it. I'm not sure. No promises. But maybe on Tuesday or Wednesday, we might see you live in the garden. And that will be me and also Mr. Steve as well. So I'm rather looking forward to that, to be honest. If it happens, the live chat is very busy. Wow. Let's have a look at some of the comments, shall we? Theo is here. I am Kurd and I am your fan. Oh, thank you very much for that. Francesca says, Mr. Duncan, I am getting used to the new time. Oh, good. I'm glad to hear it. The clocks have changed. Today, they have gone forward by 1 hour. I know that some of the countries as well also do it. The time has changed in Madrid. Today is very weird and very confusing. This is true because some people forget to change the clock. And so when they get up in the morning, they don't really know what time it is. They think it is one time. But in fact, it is another time. So it can be very confusing when the clocks go backwards and forwards. So that's what's happened today. The clocks have gone forward here in the UK. May I ask you something, Mr. Duncan? I always get worried when people ask, can I ask you something? Greetings from Argentina. Thank you, Koto. That's very kind of you. Egypt is here as well. Hosni. Hello, Hosni. Nice to see you as well on the live chat. Don't forget, everyone is welcome. Fast Idioms say, yes, it's true. I saw your live stream in the garden and I remembered admit into hospital and discharged from hospital. We will be talking about that in a few moments. Estanislao says, last night I got up at 5:30 a.m. to go to the toilet and I found my mother on the floor naked by the kitchen door, and then I had to wait half an hour until she felt like getting up. Goodness me, that sounds rather dramatic. I hope your mother is okay now, because it's Mother's Day here in the UK. So I'm very sorry to hear that. I hope your mother is feeling much better, and I'm sure you are taking care of her right now. Have you prepared the luggage for your next holiday, Mr. Duncan? Says Anna. Well, we're not going just yet, but we will be going on a trip next month in April. I'm not going to tell you where. It's going to be a big surprise. So I won't tell you until we are actually there, and then it will be a nice surprise. You can find out where in the world we have gone. A question for everyone: where are you from? We have people here from all over the world. Koto. Mustaf is here as well. Mika says, summertime in the UK is convenient for me because it's 10 p.m. Yes, it's very good if you are watching in Asia. So if you are watching ahead of our time, it's very useful because it means that I appear 1 hour earlier. So yes, you are right, Mika. It's much more convenient because it's not so late. Palmyra says, Lilia. Oh, this is a message for Lilia. Did you know that in my city there is a sweet factory called Rochen? Oh, I like the sound of that. Anything to do with sweet things and sugar, I'm in there, definitely. Please do more live streams in the garden. I love it. The only one inconvenience is that I can't finish watching it because I work at that time. Oh, I'm sorry to hear that, Guadeloupe. I might try and do some live streams earlier. So it all depends. But next week, Mr. Steve is off from work. He's not at work next week. So we might do some special live streams in the garden. It all depends on what the weather is like, to be honest. Mr. Duncan, scattered. So you want another word for scattered? Dispersed. If something has been dispersed, it means it has been scattered around. David says, I hope Brexit never happens. Well, you're not on your own. There are a lot of people who don't want to leave the European Union, to be honest. There are many people that don't want to see it happen. Massimo says, will you go abroad? Yes, Mr. Steve and myself, we are planning 2 trips, one next month and one also in June. So we are going away, and hopefully, I am keeping my fingers crossed that hopefully we will be able to do some live streams from the places that we are going to visit. So we will have to wait and see what happens. Francesca is here. Braga. Hello, Braga. Braga Photography from Brazil. That looks like, yes, Brazil. Hello to Braga Photography. What type of photography do you do? What type of photographing do you partake in? Some people take photographs at weddings. Some people take photographs of family events. Some people take photographs of nature. So there are many different types of photography around. It is Mother's Day today. We will talk about that. Yesterday we went to see Mr. Steve's mum. She was having a lovely time with us yesterday. Mr. Steve gave his mum a lovely bunch of flowers. And yes, we will be talking all about Mother's Day later on today. We will celebrate Mothering Sunday. So it is Mother's Day here in the UK. Now, I know that many other countries today are not celebrating Mother's Day. So some countries celebrate it on another day, a different day. So we are celebrating Mother's Day. We can call it Mothering Sunday, or we can call it Mother's Day. So we can say Happy Mother's Day, or as we tend to say here, Mothering Sunday. So there it is. Mother's Day is here today. And I hope wherever you are, you will say a special hello to your mum. We are talking about hospital words, also words to do with time. But right now, we're going to take a look at one of my lessons. And this is one of my full English lessons. Some excerpts coming up from Full English number 17. Here's an interesting question. How do you know if you are mad? How can you tell that you are insane? Well, apparently, if you can ask yourself the question, then there is a good chance that you are not crazy at all.
We often use the words crazy, mad, and insane to express disbelief at someone's behavior, without actually suggesting that the person being spoken to is really losing their marbles. You paid £200 for a Star Wars toy? Are you mad? You walked 5 miles in the rain to get a hamburger? That's insane. Strangely enough, we can also use mad or crazy when talking about something exciting or thrilling. We had a crazy time at the party. These low prices are mad. They have some crazy rides at that theme park. I'm crazy for you. Of course, crazy and mad can also be used to express anger. To go crazy or mad is to lose your temper in an explosive way. Of course, mental illness is not a laughing matter. However, we do have many English words, including many slang terms for appearing crazy in the head, such as balmy, bonkers, cuckoo, insane, loopy, lunatic, nuts, nutty, nutty is a fruitcake, nut job, off her rocker, off his rocker, off your rocker, round the bend, round the twist, to lose your marbles. You don't have to be mad to work here, but it helps. Do you often use slang in your English? If your answer is no, then you might want to rethink what you believe slang to be. To speak informally can be described as vernacular or colloquial speech. Slang gives new definitions to existing words. Good examples of past slang include cool and wicked, as a way of expressing that something is really good. These days we might say that something is awesome or sick. Although, having said that, by the time this lesson has been watched a few times, there will probably be another way of expressing how good or terrible something is. Using a negative word in a positive way is nothing new. In the 1990s, the word bad was used as a slang word for good. Slang is an ever-changing trend, so who knows, by 2020, we might be using great to mean awful, and garbage to mean great. In the world of slang, anything is possible. As we have already seen today, the English language can be quite confusing, especially when it comes to words that seem connected, but aren't. A good example of this occurrence is the apparent similarity between the words affluence and effluence. They look similar, as they only differ by one letter. The word affluence means the state of having money, or, more to the point, having a large and considerable amount of money. The state of being wealthy is affluence. With affluence comes great influence. So, affluence is the noun, and affluent is the adjective. We can describe a place where rich people live as an affluent area. The word effluence is a noun that describes a substance which flows from something. For example, dirty, contaminated water being released from a pipe into the sea is effluence. So the substance in this case is sewage. It is worth remembering that there is also effluent, which is a mass noun that precisely describes liquid waste and stinky raw sewage.
Here we go. Yes, Sunday, and that was a full English lesson. I hope you enjoyed that. We are live on YouTube, and yes, Mr. Steve is coming soon. Don't worry. They say that the best laid plans of mice and men sometimes go awry. And that's exactly what's happening today, because I'm not quite sure why, but Mr. Steve's camera, Mr. Steve's camera has actually stopped working. Well, it is working, but Steve looks very strange. Now, I'm not sure if he's been eating too much cabbage, but he looks like he has changed colour. So let's have a little look at what's going on with Mr. Steve. Here he comes. Please excuse the appearance of Mr. Steve, because I'm not quite sure what's going on here.
Oh, Mr. Duncan, what have you done to me? Hello, everybody. I can't really see what's going on because it's difficult for me to look on this small screen I've got in front of me. But Mr. Duncan seems to think I'm a strange colour.
You are definitely a... Well, let me just show you the output.
Oh, it's hideous.
Yes, I don't know what's happening here. I had a few technical problems this morning where all the cameras stopped working. But now your camera looks very odd. I don't know why. And it's very distracting as well. You look like you've lost all of your colour. Because this is something I don't normally do. But we're going to try and get Mr. Steve to look normal.
Well, this will be interesting. While you're playing around with the button, shall I say something about Mother's Day?
Does that look better?
I don't know. I don't know, Mr. Duncan. Maybe people can tell us. Mr. Duncan's given me a little tablet here I can easily monitor the live stream.
We don't need to talk about that, really. That's just...
Hello to Martha. Hello to Jeff. Mika says, what's happened to Mr. Steve? Martha says, I'm definitely looking green. Well, actually, you know, I felt so sick. You know, when you're feeling not very well, you do literally go green. So maybe I'm not very well, but I don't know yet. Maybe there's nothing wrong with the camera, Mr. Duncan. Maybe this is actually what I look like.
You were a bit green round the gills.
I was last week. Yes.
That's what we say. We say if a person is unwell, we say that they are green round the gills. But I just don't understand why you look so different on the camera.
Massimo says I look hideous.
It's very strange. I have absolutely no idea why you look like that.
Matrix says I look like somebody from Shrek.
You do look a bit like Shrek. I'm giving you a bit more colour now. There we go.
50 Shades of Green, says Lilla. Am I fed up with Brexit? Oh, Palmyra, don't get me started on Brexit.
Now, yesterday, Steve was sitting at the dinner table. We went for a meal with Steve's mum, and they started talking about Brexit. And Steve went into this mini...
Rant.
Yes, well, I'm just about to say that word. The mini rant. Steve was getting quite angry about the Brexit situation. But really, it's a subject that you probably shouldn't talk about in public, because there are, of course, different opinions. But you were getting quite irate.
It's almost impossible not to talk about Brexit. I was reading, actually, just before, only about half an hour ago, I was reading an article popped up, a newspaper article about depression,
okay,
and anxiety in the UK, and apparently it's gone up dramatically since Brexit, since the vote. People are becoming more and more anxious and upset, and are going to their doctors to have tablets because they are depressed and anxious over Brexit, which I can well believe, because it's the only thing that we are talking about in the UK. Nobody is talking about anything else.
This is true.
You know, some disaster could happen somewhere in the UK and it would the news would still be talking mainly about Brexit. It's just one of those things that has completely taken over the entire country, and I think is going to remain that way for some time. It was all supposed to be over on Friday. That was the date we were supposed to be leaving Europe. We didn't want to, of course, but that was the date it was supposed to happen, and that hasn't happened despite many promises. So it goes, the saga goes on and on and on. It has now become so complicated that hardly anyone knows actually what is happening, and nobody can predict what is going to happen over the next few days and weeks.
No one knows.
We could have a general election. We could have another go at Theresa May's vote on her policy. Anything could happen. We could have a new prime minister.
Okay, Steve.
They're even talking today of having a coalition government like we did in the 1940s.
I don't think anyone watching cares.
Well, people, I think people are interested in Brexit because it's actually beginning now to affect the whole world economy.
Really?
Stock markets are being affected because everybody's so worried about Brexit and the effect it will have on the European economy that people are, it's starting to affect stocks and shares and has done, I think, for a while. But as we come closer and closer to the cliff edge, as they're calling it, then it's starting to affect many different areas and all around the world. Brexit has become a complete joke, says Eric. It has. And unfortunately, we are seen as a very stable, pragmatic country, a beacon of light
In
the world, Steve. In terms of of the way we think and democracy. And it all seems to have fallen apart.
Yeah, okay, Steve, we get it. You've just talked for... See, later you'll be complaining that you haven't got time to do your bits, and that's because you've been talking about Brexit. I'm really finding it very distracting because I don't know why you're all...
Oh, I look a bit better.
No, you don't.
Oh, okay. We'll just have to stick with it, I think, Mr. Duncan.
Well, we're going to have a break in a bit anyway. When we have a break, it's...
Just come on. We'll have a break and Mr. Duncan will reset everything.
Yes, that's what I'm trying to do.
Beautiful once again.
Okay, then, yes.
Well, Mother's Day is here, Mr. Duncan.
It is Mother's Day. We went to see your mum.
We went yesterday. And I was looking up some facts and figures about Mother's Day.
Facts and figures?
It's probably not the right expression. I was doing a bit of research into Mother's Day. It's historically the celebration of motherhood, of obviously a woman giving birth, having a baby and bringing up a child. That has been celebrated throughout history for thousands of years in various shapes and forms. The Greeks, there was a goddess of motherhood. So the Greeks used to celebrate it. The Romans did. Now, we've got two expressions. We've got Mother's Day and we've got Mothering Sunday. And they're actually two separate things. Mothering Sunday is a religious celebration of motherhood. And it's mainly the Christian church. So we're talking the UK, Ireland, and some of the islands around the UK as well, and maybe a few countries around the world who are closely linked to the UK, parts of Canada, some parts of Australia, and a few other parts of the world. So Mothering Sunday is very much a religious celebration, whereas Mother's Day is a secular celebration, so it's nothing to do with religion. And the phrase Mother's Day only really started to come into being at the turn of the 20th century. It started in America around, and the first time it was properly celebrated was around 1908. And a lady whose name I can't remember started to form this celebration and wanted Mother's Day to be celebrated every day on the same day. And it has nothing to do with Mothering Sunday, which is a Christian celebration. So it was a completely separate thing. So most people around the world don't celebrate Mother's Day today. It's just basically the UK, really, and a few other countries around the world. A lot of countries celebrate. Actually, the second Sunday in May is the commonest day to celebrate Mother's Day, and that I think is this is when Mother's Day is celebrated in America, Canada, and many, many other parts of the world. It just happens that Mothering Sunday is we were brought up on Mothering Sunday, but we now call it Mother's Day, although it's not the same Mother's Day as they celebrate in America and other parts of the world. A lot of parts of the world now celebrate International Women's Day as a kind of Mother's Day as well. Russia do that. That's on the 8th of March, and a lot of other countries around that area. And it's becoming more and more prominent, International Women's Day, as a replacement for Mother's Day, apparently. But that's a little... here we go. Anne Jarvis in 1908 was an American woman who introduced Mother's Day, the modern version. And of course, the modern version of Mother's Day is very much you would say it was a very commercialized operation. And it's really a money-making exercise, cards, presents, flowers, that sort of thing. Whereas Mothering Sunday, it traditionally was just a religious celebration, and you wouldn't be going out spending lots of money. You might, because of course, being a mother is hard work. So it's something worth celebrating. I mean, just to carry a baby for 9 months is a lot of hard work. Childbirth is a very risky thing, and so a woman goes through a lot of pain, a lot of anguish, and a life-threatening, possibly life-threatening events to have a child, and then has to bring up the child because these days mothers and fathers share the workload in bringing up the children. But certainly, even when we were brought up, it was the mother that traditionally did most of the looking after the child.
Traditionally,
not so much now in Western countries, but so that's why it's celebrated, because it's amazing what women do.
Bring
us into the world.
Yes. Okay, Steve. Ooh, there. So welcome to the Mother's Day lecture. So who's the woman then who created Mother's Day?
Anna Jarvis.
Okay, then.
She didn't mean it to be a commercial thing.
No.
It just turned into that.
No.
I would imagine companies got on board.
Yes, I would imagine the same thing applies to Jesus, you see. He probably didn't realize
yes,
how commercial Christmas would become.
Probably.
He might have changed his mind, you
probably.
See.
Probably.
He might have changed his mind.
Oh, there are some. I've got some figures for you probably think, why am I saying this? Women that die in childbirth, it's still quite high. If there's no intervention for that in the sort of days before medicine, and in countries that don't have very good health care, still about 2 in 100 women die during childbirth. So, again, we need to celebrate Mother's Day because, women can die in childbirth. Apparently in the Western world, it's about 1 in 10,000 still die in childbirth. I think that's quite high. It's a very risky thing. So, we're celebrating Mother's Day today for various reasons.
And as a way of cheering everyone up, Steve decided to talk about the infant mortality rate.
No, well, not the infant mortality rate, the mother mortality rate.
Okay.
Mothers that die in childbirth. No wonder we celebrate it, because let's face it, it's a risky thing. I know we're out fighting lions to get food, and with spears and things like that. Traditionally, it's risky for the man as well, because traditionally we'd be going out hunting, I suppose. But you
traditionally,
know, a risky thing.
So today's word that Steve is using a lot is traditionally.
In the past, before civilization.
I just love the way that that cavemen are traditional.
Well, okay, so historically then, yeah, throughout most of history.
Traditionally,
traditionally, a woman would die in childbirth and the man would get eaten by the lion as he was trying to hunt it. Yes. Actually, I doubt whether we ever hunted lions for food. I don't think that ever happened because it's a bit risky. Why hunt for a lion when you can hunt for a much easier beast that isn't going to turn around and eat you? Anyway, we're already... Mr. Duncan thinks I've gone mad already.
Are you okay?
No, I'm not okay, Mr. Duncan. I'm on all sorts of pills, as you know. I went green earlier. Do I look any better, by the way? Any better? Anybody saying anything?
I have a feeling it might be the camera settings.
What's going on here, says Pedro.
Yes, precisely. That's what I'm thinking.
Yes. Well, it is. This is why we celebrate Mother's Day, because... there are a lot of risks associated with being a mother.
Yes. Well, there's a lot of risks associated with everything. I mean, yes. you could die getting out of bed. You might trip over the cat and fall down the stairs.
We're talking about mothers today.
Yes. If I'm talking, can I? If I'm talking, don't talk, because nobody can understand what either of us are saying. It's just incredible. 2 years we've almost been doing this for 2 years together. And I'm still having to explain to Steve that if I'm saying something, if you say something as well while I'm saying it, no one can understand what we're saying. Whew. We're going to have a look at... Do you have to keep banging everything around?
I'm not banging anything, Mr. Duncan. Relax, relax, calm down.
I am relaxed, but... Oh, dear.
Of course, with mothers, you can have you can have a biological mother, can't you? A biological mother. Mr. Duncan's getting annoyed already. I was talking while you were adjusting me to make me look less green. Have you succeeded? Have you succeeded, Mr. Duncan? Do I look less green?
I have no idea. What? Are you all right?
I'm fine, Mr. Duncan. Why do you keep asking me if I'm all right?
Because
you were the one that made me green.
It's not the colour that I'm worried about. So what's going on inside that?
There's nothing wrong with me. My mother had me tested.
Yes, not enough times. Yes. Anyway, we're coming up to 3 o'clock. We're going to have a look at the flag soon. We're going to have a look at some hospital words as well, because I was asked to talk about that during the week when I was in the garden, you see.
Okay.
Would you like to have a look at the live chat on the screen? Because I've given you a tablet, I think I should be giving you quite a few tablets, actually. Or maybe I should be taking some of the tablets away from you. But this particular tablet that I'm talking about is a computer tablet. So Steve can now look at the live chat very comfortably. Isn't that nice? So let's have a look at the live chat.
Yes.
Well, you can have a look at your tablet, Steve. That's why
okay,
I gave it to you.
Screen. I don't know which way you put it up there. Now I look like I've been sunbathing, according to Palmyra. Well, anyway, that's better than looking green, I think. I look like I came out of the set of UFO, said Jamila. Everyone's just talking about my appearance today, it seems, which is fine. We don't mind that at all. Yes, celebrate. Yes, all sorts of opinions on Mother's Day here.
Opinions?
Yes, there are actually. There's a few controversial opinions.
I think Mother's Day should be banned. Is anyone saying that?
Sort of.
Oh.
But yes, what's wrong? You know, there's Father's Day as well, so we celebrate fathers. On a different day of the year, and we also celebrate Mother's Day.
You know, they never celebrate sons and daughters.
Well, some countries there is a celebration of Children's Day in some countries, apparently. So yes, they do celebrate different things in different parts of the world. But you were saying something funny earlier that you think there should be a dog's day
in
the UK.
Yes, that's exactly what I think. I think there should be a special day put aside. Well, I don't think so myself, because you know I don't like dogs. I hate them. But yes, there should be a dog's day. And there it is. There is a dog, just to represent the fact that we're talking about dogs. Do you like that picture? It looks like Mr. Steve when he's cutting his fingernails, when he puts his little reading glasses on. So there you can see a dog. And I think that there probably will eventually be Dog's Day. And this will be where people buy presents and gifts for their dog. And maybe they give a card to their dog as well. So that's what I think will happen eventually. I think eventually we will have Dog Day. And the dog will be the special VIP. Because it will happen. Someone somewhere will do that. I think so. I think one day there will be Dog Day. Okay, here are some more dogs, because it would appear that lots of people like dogs.
Not everyone.
Not everyone, including me.
I see what Albulfaz has made a comment about. Celebration of Mother's Day is an injustice. Many women in the world are not mothers. Yes, that's a good point. I don't think you mean the word injustice. You mean it's probably unfair that only mothers are being celebrated. Well, that's why I said earlier there is International Women's Day, which is, when is that? I'm not sure when that is, International Women's Day. But a lot of countries now celebrate that, and Russia is one of them. And if we've got anybody from Russia watching, and I think a few other countries around Russia in the same sort of geographical area also celebrate International Women's Day as a celebration of women in general, not just mothers. So maybe that's a fairer way of doing it for some countries. But I think in the UK we're always going to have Mothering Sunday. That's always going to be around because it's a religious celebration. But yes, I see what you mean, because you're sort of saying it's almost unfair to women who don't have a baby or can't have a baby or choose not to have a child. That, how do they feel on that day? That's a very good point that you've made there, Albulfaz. I never really thought of it like that. If you're a woman on Mother's Day and you haven't had a child, do you feel left out? Do you feel disenfranchised? Do you feel upset about that? Maybe that's why International Women's Day is growing in popularity instead of just celebrating women who have children. Mothers, in other words.
And of course, let us not forget as well that the other thing you've got to bear in mind is there are a lot of people who've lost their mother as well, so that their mothers are no longer around. Yes. To actually celebrate with them. We're going to have a break now because it's just after 3 o'clock, and I think, yes, it is the moment that everyone loves. It's time to take a look at those flags from around the world. We'll be right back. You are watching Live English, and it is a Sunday afternoon with Mr. Steve and me, Mr. Duncan. I'm desperately trying to get Mr. Steve on the screen looking like a normal human being, which is turning out not to be very easy. Let's try again. Let's have another go at getting Mr. Steve up on the screen. Oh, dear me. Isn't it strange? I had some technical problems before we went on, and I thought I had solved them all. But it would appear that Mr. Steve's camera is looking very strange. I will spend the rest of the afternoon trying to work out what happened with that. So there he is again. Oh, you look better. Not much better.
Thank you to a lot of people who have said that International Women's Day is the 8th of March.
What's that? Sorry, say that again.
International Women's Day is the 8th of March. A lot of people have posted that on the live chat, so thank you for that. And I think Lilia said it's celebrated in Ukraine, I think, as well as Russia and a lot of other countries around that same area. It's just become quite popular for some reason. It's a non-religious celebration. And of course, it has nothing to do with just being a mother. It's celebrating women in general. Yes, why should you be celebrated just because you're a mother? It's unfair to women that aren't. So, yes, thank you for that point of view that somebody mentioned earlier that I hadn't really thought about before. But yes, so Father's Day, what does it feel like to be a man and not be a father on Father's Day? Maybe we need International Father's Day, International Man's Day as well, just to redress the balance.
Of course, you know what people will say, Steve? They will say that every day is Man's Day.
Don't understand, Mr. Duncan.
Well, people complain when we have International Women's Day, but there's no International Man's Day or Male Day. Yes, but and the point I'm making is people that argue against that say that, well, every day is Man's Day because men dominate everything.
Oh, I thought you meant man as in the wider meaning of the word man.
Great.
Human beings.
Yes. Okay. Well, we were talking about genders, so.
I've got another interesting fact here, Mr. Duncan.
It better be.
Well, I think it's a fact.
You think it's a fact?
Births to unmarried women. So children that are born out of wedlock, as we would say here in the UK. Somebody that has a child and isn't married, where do you think that happens the most frequently and the least frequently around the world? Any ideas, Mr. Duncan? Which country do you think has the highest percentage of children born to unmarried mothers?
I don't know.
And the country that has the least?
Again, I don't know. I think the UK might be up there.
We're sort of in the middle. In all countries, the percentage of children born to unmarried mothers has gone up dramatically since the 1980s, apart from one country. And that country is Japan.
Okay.
Hardly any children apparently are born in Japan to unmarried mothers. It must be socially, it must be an awful thing, obviously, in that culture, not to be born out of wedlock, as we would say here. That used to be such a shameful expression in the even when I was growing up in the late 1960s, early 1970s. It used to be a shameful thing, but of course it's not anymore. Which is great, but in some countries it obviously still is. So in Japan, even now, only about 2% of children are born out of, you know, to unmarried mothers. Whereas the country with the highest number of children that were born when you're not married is Iceland.
Okay, well that apparently. makes sense. I mean, it's freezing cold.
It always has been.
It's freezing cold there. That's why.
I just thought that was interesting. And the UK and a lot of the Nordic countries, as we say, Nordic countries.
As we say,
Sweden,
is that what we say?
Norway, those sort of Northern European countries, all have a high proportion of children. You know, it's not a social stigma to be born if you're not, you know, if the mother isn't married.
Stigma.
Whereas in the UK it used to be, but it doesn't matter anymore. And of course in the United States and Italy used to. Italy's still quite low. It's obviously quite a social, socially bad thing in Italy still, because theirs is still quite low. But the lowest is Japan. I was quite surprised, but I didn't know, so I don't know much about Japanese culture.
Well, clearly.
but I obviously didn't know enough about Icelandic culture either. Anyone from Iceland watching, and if you are, was your mother married when you were born? We want to know. Mr. Duncan, I'm annoying Mr. Duncan today. I don't know why.
I just don't think that this... so what is a stigma?
Well, a stigma is something that is well, you're the English teacher, Mr. Duncan. If something's a stigma, it's something that is seen as bad or socially unacceptable, or is it something that you will suffer for in society? So people will look at you and say, "Oh, that person's bad."
Yes. So you can say a mark of shame.
Yes, it used to be. I mean, probably in virtually all countries around the world, always used to be something that was seen as bad or shameful if you were an illegitimate child. So if you went, I mean, when I was at school, if we had children in the class and you knew that their mother wasn't married, it was still seen as quite a bad thing.
Hmm.
Whereas now, nobody cares now. And I think that's pretty much been the case in a lot of countries as the years have gone by. But I presume the more religious the country, the more the stigma is still there. I don't know, just generalising there, but I would imagine that probably is the case. But there you go. I just thought I'd throw that fact in there, Mr. Duncan.
Guess what? I've put your camera right.
Have you? Do I look human again, Mr. Duncan?
Well, you should be able to see on the screen.
Well, I can't really tell. Because the screen, it's not a true representation of me. I hope I'm not saying anything controversial today. I hope I'm not saying anything controversial, Mr. Duncan.
That looks better.
Average age, Palmyra says, the average age to give birth for women in Lithuania is 30. So that's another fact, again, about motherhood. I don't know what the average age is in the UK. It's got... In sort of westernized countries, the age that women have babies has got later and later, because of course a woman now can have a career and can make a success of her life, and therefore doesn't want to have a baby too early because they might want to start a career. So women are having children later and later now, which is good for society, but of course carries its own risks, because the older you are when you have a baby, the higher the chances of birth defects and things like that. So perhaps the best, perhaps if you want to be a successful career woman, then you probably need to earn a lot of money and get a nanny to look after your baby for you. That's probably the best thing. But of course that's controversial as well. Everything I'm saying today is controversial, Mr. Duncan.
Yes, but is it interesting?
I don't know. That's for the live chat to determine.
Yes, the seven people still watching.
Yes, I think lots of people watching, Mr. Duncan. Lots of people. They want to see if I go from green to brown.
Well, I've corrected it now. We're back to normal. Whatever that is.
Right. So anything else to say on mothers, Mr. Duncan? I've got a few phrases like biological mother, surrogate mother.
Yes.
Adoptive mother.
Are we just doing this for the whole hour then?
No.
Oh.
It's your show. You decide what we're doing.
Well, what the strange thing is, and this is something I don't normally like to talk about, what goes on behind the scenes, even though Steve constantly talks about it. He's always talking about what's going on behind the scenes. But I don't like to do that because it's very boring, and it also gives away too many of my little secrets, you see, how I do things.
Mr. Duncan.
Let's just get rid of Steve. There he is, gone now. So he can't keep putting faces and interrupting me. That's better. I'm on my own now. But earlier I said to Steve, and I said this 2 days ago, I said we're going to talk about time and words and phrases related to time. And I made it very clear that that's what we were doing. But for some reason, Steve has gone away and he's prepared lots and lots of things about Mother's Day and mothers and women, and nothing to do with time or idioms to do with time. And I don't know why. I don't know why Steve has prepared completely the wrong thing.
I do.
You're not on, Steve. We can't hear you. What did you say?
Well, you did say we were going to talk about Mother's Day as well. So there we go.
Yeah.
Matrix is getting annoyed because we're not answering his comments.
Briefly, we were going to say it's Mother's Day today. And then you would say, oh, yes, here's an interesting fact about Mother's Day. And then we would move on to the things that I'd actually asked you to prepare. And you didn't prepare any of it.
I have prepared them, Mr. Duncan.
Okay, then.
Matrix is getting rather annoyed that we haven't answered their comments.
Well, you've got the live chat in front
I
of
has.
You.
Come on. Matrix wants you to explain the word furthermore and moreover.
Well, they're both the same thing. Moreover and furthermore means you're going to discuss a certain thing in greater detail. There we go.
We've done it, Matrix. I hope you're happy now.
Yeah.
The thing is, we've said this before, we can't answer everything because there are so many comments.
Yes.
The whole show would turn into answering the comments and commenting on the comments, which I'd love to do personally, but Mr. Duncan doesn't want to do that.
Well,
so I'm just trying to pick out certain ones.
Yes, here's the thing, Steve. Some people don't want to hear me say hello to people all the time or answer the comments all the time. And other people want to hear other things being talked about. So we try to do something for everyone. We try to vary everything. For example, I wasn't expecting you to talk for an hour about women and mothers for an hour when I've got piles and piles of things prepared here.
Fine.
That we might not have time to talk about. It's 20 past three now.
Pedro wants to ask me a personal question. He said that before. You can ask it, but whether I answer is another thing altogether.
I can answer the question for you now.
I don't have any children.
I can answer the question for you now. No, he doesn't, and sometimes he does, but only on a Friday. There we go. There we go, you see. I've answered the question.
Do you want me to quickly go through my words on mothers?
I don't know. I think I might go in the garden and have a lie down on the ground. I still can't get you right. The picture, it's really, really weird. I have no idea what is going on here. You look like you've been on holiday. Let's just get rid. Oh, that's better. That's it. You don't look so you look like Donald Trump. There we go. Oh, that looks better, slightly more natural.
This is wonderful, Mr. Duncan. Right, I'll let me whiz through these, Mr. Duncan, and then we won't talk about mothers anymore, and it will all be done.
You've got a massive pile of words there.
I can get through them quite quickly, Mr. Duncan, quite quickly.
Yes, well, make sure you say it clearly, because there are people learning English here. You may have forgotten, but we are here to help people with their English. Okay, then off you go.
Mummy's boy or mother's boy, or in America, mama's boy.
Steve.
Were you a mummy's boy?
Steve was.
And it's a boy or a man who is particularly close and overly dependent on his mother.
Steve.
That is not me at all. I am totally independent from my mother. It's often used as a sort of a derogatory term for a man. Or a boy, to say that you haven't really grown up yet. You're a bit of a mummy's boy. So it's if someone describes you as that, it's probably It's definitely not something you ever want to be called. But if you're a bit afraid to grow up and leave home, maybe somebody might describe you as a mummy's boy. It's used a lot, mainly in the UK and Australia. They call it mama's boy in America. So that's that one. I'm throwing them on the floor. A similar phrase, but not exactly the same, is to be tied to your mother's apron strings. What that means is that you are being controlled and dominated by your mother. So if somebody is described as being tied to their mother's apron strings, so an apron is something that you wear when you're cooking to stop the splashes getting on your clothes, and there are strings that tie at the back. So it means that you're just very close to your mother and you do everything she says. For example, my husband is still tied to his mother's apron strings. He does everything she asks. So if you just do everything your mother asks you to do and you drop everything and go and do it, then it means that your mother is controlling your life maybe too much. Mother Nature. If we use the phrase Mother Nature, we just mean the natural world, everything around us, nature. But putting the word mother in there gives an implication that there is some force controlling nature. So Mother Nature, it's almost like there is somebody controlling nature. That's what that phrase suggests. And you can use a phrase like, look at the wonders that Mother Nature provides. Water, air, food, the stars in the sky, Mother Nature. It just refers to all the natural world. But you can use a phrase like, I like all my food to be as Mother Nature intended. If you use the phrase as Mother Nature intended, it means that you want everything to be... You don't want it to be being manipulated or changed in any way. You want it to be exactly as it would have grown or been produced in nature.
Natural.
So you might not... Yes, natural. You don't want foods with pesticides in it, for example. You just want it to be as it was, the fruit on the tree. You don't want it to be changed in any way. As Mother Nature, or as nature intended.
I think also it's often used to talk about things that are provided for us to use in nature. So fruit on the trees, vegetables. So anything that occurs naturally that we can consume, we often talk about Mother Nature, that Mother Nature provides these things for us. But I think it's just figurative.
It's figurative. Yes.
There isn't really a woman in a field growing all of these things for us.
No, but because there's all that wonder out there and that bounty and food and everything out there, we like to, it's almost like there is somebody looking after us and providing all this food and everything for us. So that phrase is used to suggest that we're being looked after by, you know, a higher power in some way. A mother hen is a person in a group of people who looks out for the welfare of others in an overly sort of fussy, over fussy way, over protective way. So if somebody is sort of being over fussy and over protective, then you can describe them as a mother hen, just as a hen looks after its little babies. What do you call the offspring of a chicken? I don't know. But a hen looks after its little... I wanted to use the word twiglets, but I don't mean that. A hen looks after its offspring in a very attentive way. So a mother hen is somebody that looks after some people in a group in a very overprotective way. Jane, for example, Jane is like a mother hen when we go on our walking group excursions. She's always fussing about making sure everybody's got water and sun cream and that their boots are well oiled for the walk.
Their boots are well oiled. Steve.
Somebody that's always, if you've got a, if you go out, for example, if you go to a party and there's somebody fussing over everything, making sure everybody's got a drink, everybody's got something to eat, everybody, it's almost like they don't realize that you're an adult person and you can look after yourself. My dad is such a mother hen when it comes to looking at who I hang out with. So it doesn't have to be just a woman. It can be used to describe a man who acts in an overprotective way. But usually it's a would be a woman. Somebody who's always fussing around you. Oh, do you want another drink? Are you all right? Do you want anything to eat? Can I get you a cushion to sit down on? Are you comfortable there? You know, you just think, oh, for goodness sake, oh, I'm fine. You know, so, I'm an adult.
All right. I'm starting to wonder whether Steve has multiple personalities. Do you have some sort of illness in your brain?
I'm fine. As I said, my mother had me tested. There's nothing wrong with me.
How many people are in there?
Shall I be mother? Infinite, Mr. Duncan. There's an infinite number of personalities within this seemingly innocent exterior.
You think a baby chicken is called a twiglet?
I don't know what I was thinking there.
You think a baby chicken is called a twiglet?
Maybe somebody can tell us what baby chickens are called.
They're called chicks.
Chicks, that's it. Thank you.
They're not called twiglets.
I know they're not called twiglets. I know that. I should have just let that stay in my brain and not tell everybody, not share that information. Shall I be mother? Is a phrase that's used for somebody in a group who wants to help everybody else out. For example, if there's a lot of food on a table, somebody might want to serve that food to everybody. And they may say, oh, shall I be mother? Because obviously your mother would normally put the food out for you on your plate. Say you were pouring some drinks for somebody, that there was a pot of tea and there were four or five of you all going to sit down and have a cup of tea and the pot sitting there brewing and somebody says, oh, shall I be mother? It just means, shall I help everybody and pour that tea out or serve that food or whatever? Shall I be mother? You can be the mother of something. The mother of something. It means it's the largest or most extreme or ultimate example of something. The mother load. It just means the. What's Mr. Duncan laughing at? Wow. Oh, Mr. Duncan.
Sorry.
Well, that's the mother load of all chocolate cakes. That's the mother of all Cut. Cut. Cut, Mr. Duncan, cut.
I'm still recovering from you thinking that baby chickens are twiglets.
Oh, we're having fun today. This is therapy. I don't need tablets. This is therapy, just going live on a Sunday. So the mother of something just means the largest amount of something. So if you saw a whole load of chocolate cakes all together in a shop, you might say, oh, that's the mother of all. Oh, no, if you saw a giant chocolate cake, a huge chocolate cake, the biggest you've ever seen, you might say, that's...
Please stop talking. Please stop.
Oh, I'm crying. I'm laughing so much. That's the mother of all chocolate cakes. It's just something that's very big.
You think a baby chicken is a twiglet?
If you were playing tennis with somebody and it went on and on and on and on, because as we know, tennis can be just three sets or it could be five sets, you could say that was the mother of all tennis matches.
Yes. Incredible.
Or the mother of all battles. This phrase is a relatively modern. It's a relatively modern phrase, and it was an adaptation of Saddam Hussein, because he used to use that expression. He didn't use that exact expression. This is an adaptation of what he used to say about having a big battle during the Gulf Wars in the early 1990s, having this mother of battles, this giant battle. And because of that, he used that phrase. And I think it was sort of quite widely shown on television. It was very rapidly adapted across the world to mean the largest or the biggest of something. So that's the mother of something. Here we go. This'll make Mr. Duncan crack up again. Mother Lode, spelled L-O-D-E, not L-O-A-D, because a lode is metal ore. It comes from a mining expression, meaning that we've found a giant seam of metal that we can mine under the ground. But it just means an abundance of something. So if you find a mother load of something, it just means it's a huge amount of something that you found.
Yes.
I could use this one, but shall I, Mr. Duncan? Is it too rude?
No, don't use that one.
I won't use that one.
I think Steve
it was a swear word, and I've shown it to Mr. Duncan.
Yes. Yes. Okay. We've just seen what you did. We understand. You don't have to explain actions that everyone can actually. I'm
crying with laughter.
I'm now drinking from a glass. You don't have to keep explaining everything you're doing.
You don't have to keep explaining that I don't have to keep explaining everything.
I must admit, I think I laughed so hard then, a little bit of wee came out.
That makes a change. It's usually poo.
I think I've slightly weed myself. A little bit, just a little tiny bit.
Oh, Tomek says this is the mother of live streams. Thank you very much. Oh, dear. Laughter is very good for your health. Because, you know, I haven't been in the best of health, have I, the last few weeks, Mr. Duncan? Let's face it. And going live to everybody across the world is therapy, pure therapy, and I hope it is for you too. What are we moving on to next, Mr. Duncan? This is your show.
I think I'm going to move on to a retirement home. Oh, dear me.
Oh, what a compliment. The mother of all live streams.
I'm not sure if that was a compliment. By the way, the word that Steve wanted to use started with mother. And then the second part of the word rhymes with truck or trucker. So I think we all know what that, but we can't say it.
I thought you said move on, and now you've gone back to it, Mr. Duncan.
Well, I was thinking to myself that maybe some people were wondering what the word was, so that's why I mentioned it.
I'm so tempted, but I won't.
We seem to spend more time explaining things that are actually happening in the live stream than actually explaining what we're supposed to be explaining.
What you want on your control there, Mr. Duncan, is like a bleep button. So that if I'm about to say something, you can press something rude.
Oh, here we go. This is when Steve makes a mistake. This is the new sound that we're going to use. Listen to this, Steve. There we go. So when Steve makes a mistake, that's the sound. That's the sound we're going to use. Or if Steve says something funny, it doesn't happen very often, we can have this sound. But that won't happen very often either.
Is that people laughing at me rather than laughing with me?
I think they're definitely laughing at you.
People are very intrigued about this word I'm not using now.
Yes.
Yes, Sergio, very close. Yes, it's a very... Well, we're not going to say the word, but we can say what it means.
Please don't say the word.
It's an extremely bad or unpleasant person or thing. Sometimes said seriously, sometimes said quite often now jokingly. Yes, people, you could use it, for example, if you were trying to put some self-assembly furniture together, for example.
Self-assembly
furniture.
He means IKEA.
Or so anything you buy these days, if it's furniture, quite often you have to put it together yourself. And you might say, this... Beep, 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 won't fit together. Anyway, we're not going to say it, are we, Mr. Duncan?
This mother trucker.
You beep. You're going to die for that.
Sorry?
Oh. Anyway, right, let's move on. What's next, Mr. Duncan?
Ooh, I think it might be me having a lie down in a dark room. For those who have just joined in, don't worry. This isn't the local mental asylum in Much Wenlock. This is actually live English on a Sunday with Mr. Duncan. That's me, by the way. I'm the sensible one. And over there in the corner, that is the guy that I think is having some sort of maybe a nervous breakdown.
You're watching Mr. Steve having a nervous breakdown on air.
Mr. Steve is the person who thinks that a baby chick is called a twiglet.
Oh, it's very uncomfortable on this chair, Mr. Duncan. I've got a numb bum.
Yeah, that's not the only thing that's numb.
A twiglet. What could you say would be the offspring of something that would be called a twiglet?
A baby tree.
Brain.
Do you want to see the inside of my brain? A lot of people have asked if I have a brain. This is what the inside of my brain actually looks like. This is a special x-ray of my brain. Look at that. So there it is, just
to
prove.
A lot of gaps there.
Yes. Well, there's a lot of space because of the heat, you see. It has to escape because it works so hard. Because my brain works so hard. So there it is, proof that I do have a brain, and it's like a computer.
Is that why you don't wear a cap anymore? Because that heat's got to get out somewhere.
Yes.
To cool the processor down.
I've got a little fan in the back of my skull.
Apparently, I saw a program on sort of human evolution.
Oh yeah.
The other day, and they said that the human brain couldn't actually be much bigger than it is now, because it would go over heat.
Yeah. Well, it couldn't be any bigger because it'd come out your ears.
It's literally like a computer. There's so much processing going on that if our brains were that much bigger, it would produce too much heat.
Yes. Also, your head would be too big. You wouldn't be able to stand up. You'll be able to stand up, you keep falling over.
Is it time to talk about time, Mr. Duncan?
Is it time to go?
No, we've got 25 minutes unless we run over.
Hey, I tell you what, here's something I promised I would do today, Steve. Now, we're going to talk about words to do with going into hospital, and this is something I promised to do last week. So, I wish I had a sound effect to go with this. Nee na nee na nee na nee na mee ma. That's an ambulance.
Is that the Doppler effect?
It's something. I don't know what exactly it is, but it's something. Hospital words, Mr. Steve. There are lots of words that can be used to describe going into hospital and the types of things that happen when you go into hospital. So first of all, if you are rushed into hospital, you might need one of these.
You don't want to see that turning up on your front door.
No. Well, not at your front door unless you've had a severe emergency in your hallway. But yes, you might need an ambulance. An ambulance. So an ambulance is something that takes you to hospital in a hurry. Quite often there will be blue lights flashing, and there will be a siren. Dee da dee da dee da dee da dee da dee da. Do you like that?
You've already done it. That's twice you've done it, Mr. Duncan.
That's the Doppler effect. Look at that. Ooh, aren't we intelligent? So there it was, an ambulance. Now, when you arrive at hospital, the first place you will go to if you are rushed to hospital, well, maybe you will go to a place called accident and emergency. So this is a place you'll go to if you have to go to hospital suddenly, and quite often you will have to wait. You will have to wait. So if you go to A and E, that's normally the place you'll go to if you've injured yourself in some way. Maybe you've cut your hand, or maybe you've got something in your eye, or maybe you've accidentally swallowed something you shouldn't.
Or had a heart attack.
I'm not sure if you go to accident and emergency with a heart attack.
Yes, of course you do.
Well, you turn up at accident and emergency.
Well, the ambulance will take you there.
Okay, then.
Well, where else are you going to go? To the local museum?
Well, there is another place, of course, you can go to, and this is a word we use a lot here in the UK. Casualty.
Yes.
Casualty. So this also means a place that you'll go to if you are injured, if you've done something to your body that you shouldn't have. Maybe you have something stuck somewhere and you can't get it out.
Well, yes, yes. All sorts of people put all sorts of things into their bodies and then it all goes wrong and they have to go to A&E or casualty to have them removed. I mean, of course, I quite often, my job involves me quite often seeing doctors and nurses, and they often tell me stories of people who have turned up at casualty with all sorts of things stuck in all sorts of places, and they couldn't remove them, so they had to. Very embarrassing.
Yes.
Very embarrassing.
You do wonder sometimes why a person would suddenly just decide to do that. Maybe they've got maybe they've got nothing to do. Maybe they're a bit bored, and then they notice across the other side of the room there is a large bottle of tomato sauce, or maybe a long light bulb, and they think to themselves, I wonder if that will go in my bum.
I think sometimes you have to leave these things to people's imagination, Mr. Duncan, rather than spelling them out. Lilia says, what about Article 13?
Oh, yes. Article 13 is something we've been talking about on YouTube. YouTube have been very vocal in their complaints and their protests about Article 13. A lot of people asking, what is Article 13? What is it? What is it, Mr. Duncan? Can you please tell us? Well, Article 13 is part of a proposed European Union copyright legislation created with the internet, or created for the internet, to better protect creativity and find effective ways for copyright holders to protect their content online. So this basically is all about copyright, protecting people's ownership of the things they have created. The only problem is many people are afraid that this will be used as a form of censorship to stop people from showing things or talking about things. So at the moment, it would appear that it will affect people who make memes or use photographs to make a joke, or maybe people who play computer games on the internet, because technically a computer game that you are playing, and if other people can see it, well, that computer game was designed by someone else and it belongs to another person. So some people fear that it will be used in a very heavy-handed way. So if something is used in a heavy-handed way, it means it is used or maybe even abused. So that particular power will be used in the wrong way. And in this case, it means perhaps people will be censored on the internet. Now, this only applies to Europe. So I'm not sure what the outcome will be when we eventually leave Europe, whether we will still be affected by it. So it might also affect me. It might affect me, Steve.
We'll have to be careful about the information that we use and the sources of information, perhaps, that we use.
Yes. Another thing that will happen is if you talk about a news story or if you feature an article, then that particular video can be actually removed from the internet because you are using someone else's information or someone else's news story. So if I put on my live stream a story that was published by the BBC, that might be seen as going against someone else's copyright because they published the news story eventually. So certain things will be taken from the internet. They will be removed. So yes, it's a worrying time, but it won't happen for another 2 years. So who knows? So we have 2 years to wait until Article 13 comes into effect.
Well, the European Union have been fining, is it Google, billions of euros for all sorts of things. They've been really attacking. I'm sure it's Google, or is it Facebook, or both? I'm not quite sure now.
You're telling us.
But they've been applying, the European Union have been applying, and there's a certain person who's been, they're really gunning for the the internet, Facebook and Google, and internet providers like that at the moment, aren't they, Mr. Duncan, to try and control what is being seen as a medium that's got a bit out of control in terms of what is allowed on there.
Yes, most of it is about people's information, data, so that they are misusing the data that they are collecting. They're selling it to other people and using it in malicious ways.
Yes. So,
but it's interesting today that the owner of Facebook has said that he wants the internet to be more controlled and more censored. Which is odd, because years and years ago, one of the things that Mark Zuckerberg was very proud of was the openness of the internet. And now he wants it all to be closed and censored. To be honest with you, I don't agree with that.
Well, the problem is there's two schools of thought there, aren't there? There is the school of thought that says everything should always be free and open, and all information should be available, and everybody ought to be able to say anything they want in a free and open society. But the problem is that often then becomes abused by people, and then it can be offensive, anti-religious, anti-race, or, you know, you've got to be... The problem is, if you let people just do whatever they like, they usually abuse it. When I say they, I mean generally people. If something isn't controlled, that you do have to have, I mean, a certain amount of control. I mean, we've got free speech here, but you can't say anything you want. You can't say things that might incite racism or anti-religious feeling. There isn't. Very few countries have complete freedom of speech. There are always some things that you can't say because it could be very offensive or incite violence. So maybe Mark Zuckerberg has realised that he is incapable of controlling Facebook himself. So he's saying, "Look, governments." Legislators, it's about time that you do this and you put some controls in place. Maybe that's what he's saying, because I haven't seen much information or have understood what is behind what he's said.
Yes.
But it's been talked about for some time that Facebook and other social media sites need to have some form of control, and maybe he's finally accepting that they probably do.
Yes. From my point of view, Steve, I think it goes against the original concept of the internet and cyberspace. And maybe not many people know that the original concept of cyberspace was a place where people can be free and can express what they think. So almost it was almost a thought utopia. So that's the whole concept of cyberspace.
Yes.
And the internet. So it was supposed to be something that would allow human beings to express what they think and share their thoughts and ideas. And sometimes they might disagree, but that is the nature. That's also the nature of society. So imagine if you controlled society in the same way that people want to control the internet. We would all be taken off the streets in about 2 hours. Because of all of our thoughts and all of the things that we want to say, and sometimes the things we do say. So you would have a very strange situation. So I think the internet is a place where everyone should be allowed to say what they want and what they feel, and you have the right to disagree.
But as long as that doesn't, the problem is that certain percentage of people will use that to abuse people,
yes,
and push forward their political or agendas,
yes,
and it can become quite dangerous then. So you probably need to have Just as I said before, we've got freedom of speech here in the UK, but you doesn't mean you can say anything you want. Mm. You can't say something that would that is abusive or could incite racial hatred. So you'd have to have some controls in place.
So would you blame World War II? Would you blame World War II on the internet?
No.
No, you wouldn't, would you? Because it wasn't around, and yet we still had World War II. We still had what happened in Germany. We still had the rise of the far right, and there was no internet. So all of that happened with no internet.
I don't see your point, Mr. Duncan.
Well, the point is everyone's saying that all this will come back because of the internet.
What? We'll have another world war because of the internet?
No. Extremism is the thing you just mentioned.
No, I didn't mean extremism. I'm just talking about abuse.
Yes,
and misuse of information.
Yes.
I'm not talking about... it's one thing to have a debate about a subject.
Yes.
And share your view, and everyone's got different views. It's quite another then to tip into abuse. You don't want to allow people, really, I don't think, to say things on the internet that is one is not factual and could be used to incite racial hatred or hatred towards certain religions.
Yes,
I think that would be. I know it happened before.
That's extremism.
Well, exactly. And everyone's entitled to their point of view, but you can't allow total freedom, I don't think.
Okay,
there has to be some control somewhere. There's got to be a balanced approach that doesn't suppress.
So if I walk
too much freedom of speech.
Yes, okay, I've got it. So if I walk down the road and say something you don't like, you can actually sort of drag me into a corner and punch me in the face because you don't like what I've said.
I know. Ah,
you could
yes.
have me removed from the street.
Yeah, but if you say something abusive to me,
yes,
or something that's factually incorrect,
okay,
then I might have reason to be upset.
Yes, but you wouldn't be able to do anything because there's freedom of speech.
Well, some people do things, don't they?
Yes, but that's nutcases and extreme moments of anger.
We're not going to get to the. We're not going to be able to answer that question today.
Oh no, I'm not trying to. This is what the internet is for. It's about talking about different subjects. Sometimes you agree and sometimes you disagree. That's life. That's society. That's the internet. That's everything.
The problem is, 95% of the human race is good and wants the best for everybody. But 5% or 10%, I don't know what the percentage is, probably psychopaths who are going to try and control and rule the earth.
So you were just talking about facts.
Bad things.
So you were just talking about getting facts right and you're just making up facts there.
Well, I wasn't saying that it was a fact.
Oh, okay.
I was saying that it wasn't a fact and I didn't know the exact percentage of bad
people. So where did you get 95% from?
Well, as I said, I didn't say it was a fact.
Okay,
said somewhere around. What I'm saying is that most people are good, but a lot of people are bad. And whenever there's something open and free for everybody to use, then it's abused by, let's say, bad people.
Okay.
Bad ends.
Bad things, yeah.
Bad things, exactly. That's right. So you've got to protect society against the bad people.
Okay, yes. Well, I think we have laws for that, don't we?
Well, exactly. That's just what we're talking about. The internet has to have some kind of control in order to prevent these, abuses taking place.
Yes. Okay. That's why we have laws and the police, because then if you hit someone in the face but saying something to someone isn't really, I don't know. I don't think you can drag people into a police cell for saying something.
Well, you can if they're racially abusive towards you.
Oh, yes, but that's inciting, and that's
that's exactly what I'm talking about.
But that's not happening all the time.
Well, I know it isn't happening all the time, but it's happening some of the time, which is why you need to say no, you can't say that, or you can't do that.
No, I think the internet should be free. That's the original way it was intended.
Yes, but it was what it was intended by a person of who has complete faith in the human race to be always good.
Okay.
But unfortunately, they're not, as we know throughout history. There are very, very bad people that come along and will manipulate and use information to their own advantage and their own gain at the expense of everybody else. And okay, that's what laws and legislation has to protect everybody else against. Hmm. So, yes, freedom of speech, but not that it becomes abusive or twisted by bad people.
Yes.
Is what I'm saying.
The problem is, and this is the problem with laws and control and censorship, they will come for your neighbour, they will come for your friends, and then one day they will come for you. And that's the way it works. So when you start censoring things, where do you stop? Where do you actually draw the line to say, that's where we're going, we're stopping there? But then someone might say, oh, no, but I don't agree with what this guy says. He should also be censored. Oh, OK. You end up with China, basically. You end up living in China.
Yes, but we're not. And we're in a democracy. And
we can
vote people out in 4 years if we don't like them. So it's extremely unlikely that in most of the Western world, you might have your doubts about America at the moment, but that you would get somebody into power that would suddenly become a dictator and change all the rules. I mean, you know, it can happen. Anything can happen. We're living in a time when, since the Second World War, where everything is peace is in most part of the world is in most of the world has been in the Western world. We've lived certainly in Europe. Which is why we wanted to stay in Europe, because the whole European Union was formed in order to make sure there were no more wars in Europe, and we don't want to go back to that.
Yes, but we are
again.
About.
So there's always that risk that extremism is on the rise around the world.
Well, I was about to. That's the point I was trying to make earlier. That today they were talking about extremism in the UK becoming more and more apparent.
Yes.
But it's not just the internet. You can meet people in the street or in a community center and talk about these things.
Of course.
So if you do it on the internet, you've got to do it in normal society as well. So you've got to raid these places, drag all these people away and put them in prison cells, just like they do in China.
Well, we're not about to do that.
No. Well, I hope not, or else...
I don't think things have got that bad yet.
I think they will be coming. They will be coming for you and I first.
Well,
definitely, they'll be coming for us too. First of all, I think that's it. Still, it could be worse. We could be living in Brunei. We're going in a moment. Let's have one last look at the live chat.
Go on.
There it is.
I'll look at it on my tablet or your tablet.
Well, it doesn't matter whose tablet it is.
Well, I haven't got one of my own. Right, Pedro's going to bed after this live stream.
I think I will.
I think I will as well. And it's still daylight here.
Okay. I'm enjoying the silence, Steve.
Well, I'm just Sergio says, are you trucking our brains? I think he means something else.
Yes.
That's a resonating topic. Yes. Okay. Some people agreeing, some people not, as you would expect. But of course, we're not going to censor any of your comments.
No.
Because they're all there for everybody to see.
Yes, that's it. I mean, sometimes I might get rid of someone from the live chat, but that's normally if they're personally attacking someone, or maybe if they are just advertising something that I don't want on here. Because if they want to advertise on my live chat, they should send me money and then they can advertise all they want. If you want to advertise something on my live chat, just make a donation and then I will let you do it. But if you just advertise and you don't give anything to me, it's only fair, I think.
I think we've been having a bit of abuse on the live chat. I'm trying to understand what's been happening.
Oh, I see. Really?
But yes.
Well, we've got moderators here, so I hope they've been doing their job.
Maybe we've been inciting all sorts of unsavory behavior.
I don't think anything we say is really bad. It's all fairly tame. But the problem nowadays is someone somewhere on the planet, because don't forget there are 7 billion people, not million, billion. And so someone somewhere will be offended by anything. You could walk down the road with a hat on your head and it might say howdy, and someone somewhere will be offended by that. And that's the problem. The problem is nowadays it's very hard to do anything without offending someone, because everyone is tuned in to the internet. Everyone is watching and listening to what is happening. But again, going back to my original point, that is the point of the internet, isn't it? To share ideas.
Yes, which Twitter, very good at.
Twitter is the worst place. It really is, for ideas and arguments. And quite often people say some very strange things.
Lewis has made a comment which is something that is resonating very much again with people who voted to leave the European Union.
Okay.
But I don't think Mr. Duncan wants me to go back to that subject.
No. You talked about that for almost 10 minutes earlier.
We did.
Quite a large chunk of the show was taken up with you talking about Brexit.
The problem, Lewis, is that because the vote was very close, 52% to 48.
Yes.
That was only a percentage of the people who actually voted. It's generally assumed that most people in the UK do, in fact, want to stay in. And that has been the whole problem. Okay. And in fact, the people, the vote leave campaigners were accused of spending money incorrectly on their campaign, and they appealed against it, and they've just apparently today announced that they're going to drop their appeal. In other words, some quite prominent members of Prime Minister May's government are basically guilty of misuse of funds when they were running their Vote Leave campaign.
Yes.
So it's going to be very interesting to see how that develops.
But all of that is irrelevant now, because we're 3 years down the road and we still have no solution in sight. So it doesn't matter about all of this. All of this is just pointless squabbling between groups. What you actually need is some sort of resolution, because it has to be sorted out. We have become the laughing stock. The whole world is laughing at the UK because we seem so indecisive and so, I want to use the word, pathetic.
There's a huge conflict. It really has opened up the divisions in society, the divisions within political parties. I mean, to be talking about a coalition government is, you know, which we haven't had since the Second World War, just shows how that people are now talking about that as the only way out of this. Just shows how serious it has become.
You know, we had a coalition government about 6 years ago, 5 years ago.
No, I'm talking about a cross-party coalition, about all the parties coming together.
That's not going to happen.
Well, apparently it's something that may well happen, that the only way out of this is to have a general election, and whoever wins then invites all the other parties in to the cabinet to actually try and sort this mess out.
What a ridiculous idea.
I think they should have done that from the beginning. And then we wouldn't be in this mess now. They could have all come to an agreement over how they wanted to proceed with Brexit. That it would have all been over. But because May pushed her own agenda and has excluded everybody else's, and nobody likes it. That's why we're in this mess.
Yes, okay then, Steve. Thank you very much for your editorial. It's not quite why we're here. I feel like I'm reliving yesterday's meal. Steve was banging on the table. He was getting really angry yesterday.
I wasn't getting angry. I wasn't banging on the table.
There were people...
Mr. Duncan's exaggerating.
There were people watching us.
No, they weren't.
I thought we were going to get thrown out.
Not at all.
Anyway. This might be the worst live stream we've ever done.
Or the best.
No, I think it might be the worst. So we might not be saving this. I might erase this.
It's the greenest.
I'm going to hit the delete button as soon as this finishes, because I don't quite know what was going on today at some point. Steve seemed to be having a very public nervous breakdown, and the fact that he thought a baby chick is called a twiglet.
Oh, there are people at the door. Have you come to take me away?
Yes, they have.
Are we going, Mr. Duncan? We've got no tea cakes or hot cross buns today.
And I wanted to talk about hospital words, and I only got two of them.
Well, perhaps we can continue that next week, also with words to do with time.
Do you want to continue it last week? Shall we go back in time? Have you got your time machine, Steve? We're going back in time, apparently, to last week. I wish we could.
Yes, I wish
we could go back to this morning.
We can't turn back the hands of time, Mr. Duncan, and undo what this live stream has become.
We definitely can't undo the damage that we've done today. I think that's safe to say. We're going now anyway. At least Steve's going anyway. So we will see you later, Steve, next Sunday, I believe.
Okay.
Mr. Steve will be back next week, and thanks for joining us.
Bye-bye.
I'm shouting stand by to Steve. He's just why are you still talking, Steve? You're not on now. That's it, your bit's finished, for goodness sake. We were out in the car yesterday, by the way, and some people ask, what is Mr. Steve's driving like? So here is a short video clip to show you what Mr. Steve's driving is really like. So there it was, and I don't know about you, but I thought Steve was driving rather fast there. What do you think? One last look at the live chat, and then we are out of here. Let's have a look. Live chat, very busy. Bye from Derby. Bye, Lilia. Bye also to Rylan. Thank you, Matilde, Louis, Narcisse. Thank you very much. Also, who else was on the live chat? Let's have a look. Let's go back. Thank you also to Nikolai, also Eric, Martha, Tomek, Sukat. Also we have Anna. No tea cakes today, unfortunately. We didn't buy any because we went to see Steve's mum. So unfortunately, we didn't get any tea cakes yesterday. I love watching you laugh so hard, says Sukat. Well, we had a lot of laughs today, mainly due to Mr. Steve and some of the strange things he was saying. Thank you very much for your company today. It's been a great day. Thank you very much to Junko, Jeff, also Martha and Maria and Julie. Thank you very much for your company today. It's been an interesting one. And that's putting it mildly. It's been a very interesting one. We had lots of things today, talking about Brexit, Article 13, mothers, women, dogs. We had Mr. Steve having a nervous breakdown. And also we had myself and you as well. I will see you next week. This is Mr. Duncan in the birthplace of English saying thank you very much for watching me. We might appear during the week live, maybe outside or here in the studio. That remains to be seen. And of course, until next Sunday or during the week, you know what's coming next. Yes, you do. Ta-ta for now.